And
the stage is yours.
Okay, thank you. So before we get started, of course, you know we got the back and forth. So I have to clear something up. So we may not have been the first HBCU, but we are the first private Black owned and operated HBCU in 1856.
There we go. Yes.
Okay. And I did.
We're happy to share the stage with you.
We have that with Lincoln. We have it with Cheney. We have the same thing. It's all good. We all know that, you know, we're here, and that's the thing. So thank you very much again for having me for this. I am honored. I have also been an educator for 15 years in the K-12. I was an ELA instructor for grades 6-12, starting in at a charter school in Akron, Ohio, and also brought that down here to Columbus, Ohio. So again, thank you very much. And I'm going to attempt to share my screen. Have I been made the co-host so I can share my screen? Okay, I will give this a shot. You know how technology works or doesn't.
Yeah.
No, it says disabled it. I need permission. It says host disabled participant screen sharing.
Okay, Zabe, can you make sure that Dr. Porter has a screen share that she's made a co-host?
Don't you love technology?
It's beautiful when it works.
I still don't have access.
Bukar, is that something you can do? Bukar, can you make her co-host?
Salaam alaikum, Dorothy. Make who a co-host?
Dr. Porter.
Okay, give me 1 second. Let me find them on my participants. I'm clicking on the 3 dots next to her name. It's not giving me an option to make her a co-host. I don't know if Zabe or anyone else can see it.
Oh.
We'll figure that out though. Let's see.
All of my stuff is on my PowerPoint.
Am I a host, Dorothy? Have you made me a host for the meeting?
It's Zay. Here, she said she's doing it right now.
Oh, okay, cool.
Thank you.
There you go.
Sorry about that, Kim. Thank you.
That is fine.
Yes, Dr. Kim Kimberly is a co-host.
Yep. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Let me come on. All right. And now we're waiting for my internet to cooperate or whatever it is that it does.
Yeah.
Okay, I guess I'm finally ready. Thank you. Thank you so much for your patience, everyone. Okay, so my topic in Black History and Education is the Black American experience with education. Oh, come on. That is not what I wanted to do. I'm very sorry.
It's okay.
I don't understand why they did that. Let me stop sharing for a moment and then share again. And those of you who are out there laughing, stop.
No one is laughing. think everyone has had their fair share of Zoom moments right now.
Oh my gosh, what is going on? Okay. We're going to do it old school. I'm very sorry again. All right, we're going to do it this way. So everyone's just going to have to see the other pictures because I don't understand why this is doing this. Okay, so the year 2020 really brought to light the social condition of 21st century Black America, the summer of Black Lives Matter, social injustice, and economic turmoil brought forth more cultural awareness and a call to support our own. Are you kidding me? Okay, there we go, sorry. The Black-owned businesses were being featured during this pandemic almost daily on local and national news outlets. And interest in enrollments in HBCUs grew with the historic campaign and subsequent election of Vice President Kamala Harris, a Howard University graduate. However, with all of the momentum that is sweeping the country, one thing really hasn't changed, and that is the educational system. Now, my next statement may be difficult for some to hear, but truth isn't always comfortable. And that is, the educational system in this country was built upon and still operates on systemic racism. From this nation's beginning, educating Black people was discouraged and even considered to be a crime. However, there were individuals and groups of white people, such as the Quakers, who defied the convention and made the choice to do so. But even after slavery was abolished, separate but equal Jim Crow laws made it difficult for Black children to receive a quality education. It wasn't until the historic Supreme Court ruling in Brown versus the Board of Education in 1954 that some strides were made regarding the education of Black children. But even then, Black students face constant, sometimes violent challenges. Although things have improved since then, racism, albeit no longer as overt as it was before, still permeates the educational system. So I have 3 points that I would like to discuss about the Black experience in education. And my first one has to do with research. So in this country, the majority of teachers in urban school districts are white and female. In fact, the lack of Black teachers, particularly Black male teachers, was the subject of my doctoral dissertation. So here are a few statistics. So as of 2017, 7% of the nation's 4 million educators were African-American, while nearly 51% of the 50 million public school students were African-American. So that is a huge and disturbing disparity. Many Black students now can go most, if not all, of their K through 12 years without having a Black teacher. So I was fortunate in the school district that I went to, Cleveland Public Schools, where from kindergarten, I believe, to third grade, I had Black teachers. I didn't have my first white teacher until I was in fourth grade. And so forth, going on through high school, I had Black teachers, but that's not the case in many school districts. Okay, I want to make sure it came up. K through 12 students benefit both academically and socially. I'm sorry. Yeah. So I'm saying why this is important. So K through 12 students benefit both academically and socially from interacting with teachers who look like they do. That's kind of a, almost kind of a duh, but it's important. In addition, these teachers can serve as role models, you know, and someone that students can relate to. Research has shown that the presence of Black teachers has been associated with positive academic outcomes of Black students. Now, on the other hand, research has also shown that the opposite is true with regard to interactions with white students. I'm sorry, white teachers. In some cases, racial bias, whether unconscious or conscious, affects relationships between white teachers and Black students, which also contributes to the problem of the achievement gap. These issues can be manifested in things like increased IEPs for Black students who may not need them, not encouraging advanced classes, such as, you know, AP courses, not informing students about scholarship opportunities that aren't related to sports, such as music scholarships, academic scholarships, and others. And teaching inaccurate and culturally homogenous lessons. And that brings me to my second point, which was already discussed, curriculum. Sorry, having a problem again, curriculum. So in school districts across the country, American children are immersed in European history, no matter what school district, suburban, rural, private, charter, it doesn't matter. They are immersed in European history. They learn about the kings and queens of England. They learn about Spanish explorers, and they learn about Italian artists. But there is virtually no mention of what was going on in Asia, in India, and certainly not Africa, unless you're talking about ancient Egypt. And even when there are lessons about ancient Egypt, children are not taught that there were many, many pharaohs who were Black. So it's usually about the slave trade when Black people are mentioned in lessons and talking about enslaved people. So as a result, teachers try to cram Black history into 1 month, and that's the shortest month of that. It is during Black History Month that the contributions of African Americans are taught. Only recently have the lessons evolved from teaching only about icons such as Martin Luther King Jr., Harriet Tubman, Rosa Parks, as we just discussed in the last session, and Frederick Douglass. There's still room for improvement, though. The accurate contributions of Black people can and should be inserted into all core subjects and not just offered as an elective or an afterthought. So for example, for every lesson taught about Thomas Edison, it should include Louis Latimer. And he was the man who discovered the carbon filament, invention that improved the light bulb and made it more practical and made it more affordable. So without his invention, there would be no light bulb. But of course, he is not given credit. All credit is given to Thomas Edison. So for every lesson about President Franklin Delano Roosevelt, it should include artist Selma Burke, whose sculpture was the inspiration for the Roosevelt dime. Not too many people have heard of her. When discussing explorers and talking about particularly Admiral Perry, there should be a lesson about Matthew Henson, who actually arrived at the North Pole before Perry. He was there first, and then Perry and his party came second. So Matthew Henson should be celebrated. for every lesson about pioneering women in aviation, they always talk about Amelia Earhart, but Bessie Coleman should also be included. She was the first Black person to even earn a pilot's license. Now, she had to go to Paris to learn because she was not allowed to attend any of the aviation schools here, but she went to Paris and she was the first Black person to not only get a pilot's license, but to get an international pilot's license. So the list goes on and on and on. I could, like I said, it's there's so, like we said before, there's so many other things that people don't learn about or don't know about and that need to be taught. And 1 month, and again, like I said, especially the shortest month, cannot hold all of our history. And more of which is uncovered every day. From the Moors who lived in Spain, who ruled Spain, I'm sorry, for 800 years, to Jean-Baptiste du Sable, who in the 1700s founded the settlement that will become Chicago, Illinois. So how many people knew that Chicago was actually founded by a Black person? People in Chicago do because there are monuments and things up to them, but it's not taught in the school. That's my point. How many children, when discussing the history of computer technology, are taught that computer scientist Mark Dean was a co-creator of the IBM personal computer? Or that Marie von Britton Brown, I think I pronounced that correctly, invented the home security system in 1966. She was a nurse that invented this system and has, and the picture there has the patent for it. So when I was in the classroom, I incorporated cultural contributions in my English language arts lessons. I didn't wait until February to teach about Black authors. My personal favorite down there is Three Musketeers author Alexandre Dumas, who a lot of people did not know was Black. And I remember the first time I brought this up in one of my lessons, because really, kids are not really interested in Three Musketeers or Shakespeare or anything like that. But when I brought up that he was Black, and when I brought up his picture, in fact, this very picture that's down there, I'll never forget it. One of my students actually stood up in back of the room and yelled, "That looks like my Uncle Junebug." That was an experience. They really, that alone made them start becoming more interested in Three Musketeers and in literature in general, okay? excuse me. Now there are many teachers, I don't wanna make it seem like none of this is going on. There are many teachers of all races who are using their autonomy to expand their course subjects, and I applaud them for it and I thank them for it. And these people here are only a few of the scores of Black people who have made contributions to anything and everything, like the spatula. Who knew that a spatula was patented by a Black woman? I just put that on my Facebook when I saw that the other day. But just little things that you don't know about that we have our hand in and that we created. Excuse me. Even talking about people who gave us the traffic light, Garrett Morgan, who was also a Clevelander. He also invented the gas mask that saved many, many people in World War I. People who sang opera, such as Marian Anderson, and people who fought in wars and who even designed Washington, D.C., Benjamin Banneker, look that up. Many of them do not appear in mainstream textbooks. The books used in American schools perpetuate systemic racism, which brings me to my third point, my third and final point, psychological manipulation. And I might sound strong, but bear with me. Okay, I want you guys to take a few minutes to look at these pictures. Okay, just take a few minutes to look at this first one. Think about what you're seeing there. Let's go to the second one. And now let's look at this third. Okay, so let's go back to this first one. This picture is from an elementary workbook. elementary school, children learning how to read and write at a very early and impressionable age. Let that part sink in. Notice that the positive words are attributed to white children, happy, proud. But the negative words are attributed to Black children, sad and angry. Okay, let's go to the second one. All right, so I'm sure you read what was in the box. So I'll read what's in the box. The Atlantic slave trade between the 1500s and 1800s brought millions of workers from Africa to the Southern United States to work on agricultural plantations. Workers. That one word negates the brutality of the people that were brought from Africa and enslaved in this country. They make it seem like it's something that they wanted to do, but that one word does a lot. They did not come here in search of a better life and to work like many other immigrants did in the years following. All right, let's look at this gem. Okay, this is not how enslaved people were brought to this country. They were not treated as tourists on a voyage. Okay, they weren't. They were chained in inhumane ways at the bowels of ships and brought over here. Again, this visualization takes the sting, so to speak, out of the truth. And this is what children are being taught. These pictures and things are from actual textbooks that are being used in the United States. And this is the example of the subtle racism that is put into our books and into our lessons. Unfortunately, there are more. And also, also by not including the accomplishments, especially the aforementioned accomplishments I just told you about, not mentioning these in textbooks, Black children don't see the positive role models of their ancestors. They don't envision themselves as scientists, inventors, authors, playwrights. They don't believe that they can achieve great things. This is what they learn in school. And once they're out of school, it is people like the community that try to tell them, yes, you are, yes, you can. But then they go back daily, being reinforced, no, you're not, no, you can't. There's no evidence. And it's a back and forth that children go through. And this starts to bother them psychologically. So in examples that I showed you, the children don't see themselves as being great. They see themselves as being less than others. And unless this is addressed both inside and outside of school, it's going to manifest itself in negative ways as they get older. So also the inaccurate portrayals of the dark moments in history, again, like slavery, can influence how white students view other races, how their sense of superiority. Students may, have the opinion that slavery wasn't so bad, or that forcing Native Americans from their land was best for them. We're talking about the Trail of Tears and so on and so forth, when we know that nothing was further from the truth. So what can be done about this? What can be done about this problem with education in America? Educational leaders in America need to acknowledge and own the systemic racism that is in this system and how they can rebuild it. In many ways, this has started to happen. So attitudes have begun to change very slowly. Some monuments of historical figures who were hailed as great heroes have been taken down. Notably here in Columbus, as Dorothy and I can attest to, and everyone else can attest to, two prominent statues of Christopher Columbus were removed, one from in front of City Hall and the one from on the campus here at the campus of Columbus State Community College. Racist attitudes of notable Americans such as Margaret Sanger, and if I'm about to step on some toes, I'm sorry, but this is the truth. And like I said, the truth is not always comfortable. I know many people hold Margaret Sanger in high regard as being the founder of Planned Parenthood, but she has also been noted for some racist quotes, and there's one right there on the screen. So these things have been revisited and have been discussed. Here again is an example of dealing with an uncomfortable truth. Something else that can be done, again, which is another almost a dumb moment, is more Black teachers simply are needed in the classroom, not just in the urban classroom, but again, in the suburban, in the rural, private school, charter school, there needs to be more of a representation, excuse me, of African-Americans in the classroom as leaders. And finally, seamless inclusion of contributions of Black people need to be done into mainstream curriculum. Now, Black History Month, love it. And I remember when it was Black History Week. That's how I'm that old. I remember that part. So Black History Month is a time to set aside, is a time that was set aside to highlight Black achievements, to highlight Black people in history. Just like, and this might be news to some people, Asian Pacific Islander Month is in May, which that is set aside, May is set aside for that. And Hispanic Heritage Month is set aside from mid-September to mid-October. Why they split the month, I don't know. And I remember when I first brought this up, the church that I attended, there were quite a few Hispanic members. And I brought that up for a reason, and they were floored. They did not know that they had a month. It, like I said, split in between 2 months, but still, yes, they have their time as well. So of course there is much to be done, and it will not be done in a day. It will not be done in a month. It may not even be done in a decade. Nor will it be done by only one race of people, but it can be done. It must be done, and it will be done. We all continue to make history every day that we purpose to do something positive in this country, whether it's mentoring the youth, presenting a program such as this. This is all making history. And I want to finish by paraphrasing a line from my favorite Broadway musical. Improving the Black American experience in education is not a moment, it's a movement. And let's keep this movement going. Thank you. I am done.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Porter. And yeah, that's my favorite too. It's not a moment, it's a movement. I remember when I first heard that line. I'm also old school, so I told the kids, I said, somebody give me my pen and paper, because for it to stick, I've got to write it down. But yeah, it's not a moment, it's a movement. And again, that's what we're trying to share here. That's what we're all on this Zoom, just reminding ourselves as social change agents that while this is called Black History Month, it's not just a month. What we set out to accomplish every day in the work we do and the people we serve cannot be accomplished if we regard this type of work and this type of rich information to be something that we can cram into a month. So thank you. Thank you. It's time for everybody to talk now. It's time for everybody to speak up. Facebook, I'm with you. If you have something you want to share, go right ahead. I would love to hear from one of the young people from our organization and just see how they're feeling about what we're sharing today. And if they've mentally written something down, if they ask somebody to get them a paper and a pen, if there's something that you told yourself, I gotta do that differently. I have to make a mental note to make sure that I'm not doing that.
Good morning, Dorothy. How are you?
Good morning. I'm well, son. How are you?
Good, good, good. Yeah, I mean, I could just speak briefly. Good morning, everybody. Well, this afternoon, it's about noon. It's about 12 o'clock now, but my name is Bakar. I'm one of the youth directors here at My Project USA, and I've been here since like the first lecture. So after hearing from the first one and after hearing from Kimberly, definitely it's been very empowering on myself. I mean, and this is me just being honest and frank. I feel like myself and I feel that other kids, you know, especially from the West Side, we grow up and we just look at Black History Month as, you know what I mean? We don't acknowledge the people and the revolutionists who really built this country, you know what I mean? And so hearing, you know, Dr. Kimberly Porter talk and hearing the last lecture has definitely given me a sense of awareness about the history that has gone on. And I definitely feel like, you know, I definitely took a lot of takeaways from today. So I just wanted to just say that and thank, you know, Dr. Kimberly Porter for her time today as well, so.
Anybody else have something to share? Dr. Porter, you're getting outstanding presentation, awesome presentation from Facebook, no questions. But yeah, I am just, again, thankful that you reminded us about how critical education and educators are in the lives of our Black children. We, again, are an organization that serve that with Zubeda, she shared the research definitions of Black and African American. We serve the low income spectrum. So we, of course, serve children who are African American. We serve children who are Black, new American immigrants to America. And what I always try to share, even though I know the research and the public opinion, it changes sometimes about who Black History Month is for. I think it's important that we have these conversations in organizations like ours, because when these young people and these adults are walking through the door of a school, a higher education institution, a store, a Macy's, a Nordstrom, nobody's asking them for their status, for their immigrant status or how long they've been here. They are seen as a Black person standing that tall. So it's usually an afterthought of how they got to be Black in America. But that's how I feel this conversation is special and important to all of us. I see Dr. Ayanna has her hand raised. Julia has her hand raised. Ayanna, go ahead and unmute and take and do you, and then we'll go to Julia and then Nadine, please.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you. Hello, everyone. I'm glad to be here. Thank you so much, Dr. Porter and Ms. Hassan. I just wanted to know if Dr. Porter could talk a little bit about just some ideas of how we should continue to recognize and elevate and further develop the importance of Juneteenth. How can we have this same type of energy in other months, right, outside of February, and what that might look like?
First of all, one way that we can keep this energy is to remember and to know that Black history is 24/7, 364, 365, sometimes 366. I mean, it's Black history is all history. And again, to incorporate that into just daily routines and daily lessons would be a start. Juneteenth, it would be great if it was made a national holiday. I know of some people who are doing some things in other cities to make sure that Juneteenth is as prominent, if not more so, than July 4th. There are people who have replaced their July 4th celebrations. I did notice that a lot in 2020. They replaced their July 4th celebrations with Juneteenth. So it might be an individual thing. I don't think it's going to take like any kind of a mandate. It would be nice if it eventually does that, but in order to make it start and to gain that momentum until it is a mandate, start with your own circle, start with your own family, start with your own community. Reinforce what is being taught in your schools with your children, with your nieces, with your nephews, with young people. It has to start, it basically starts with the young people as far as, you know, making it more accessible and making it more mainstream. Start with your youth.
And Dr. Porter, I take you threw that football at me. I take hold of it. That's what we're doing. So how do you make Juneteenth special? How do you make Black History 24/7, 365? You find organizations who are working hard to be about that mission and to be about that message. You message people like little old Dorothy Hassan and say, hey, I have this idea. I want to plan. I want to take the lead for this. And I think that your education department would be a great jump off place for me. And I say, yes, thank you. Come on through. So yeah, the youth, that is what we've been doing here. Hopefully, again, everyone is here at 1 o'clock to join us as we are joined by our executive director. And she is going to take that time to highlight some of our trailblazers who we take very much pride in. One of them, of course, was Bakar, who opened his microphone and spoke with us earlier. But these are the young people. This is our OSU student who is the director of our youth engagement here at My Project USA. And all these other young people, names that you see, we're going to hear from one of them right now. Nadine. You're muted, sweetheart.
Well, she works out her issue, her audio issue. You guys hear me?
Yes, great. Thank you for the save, Julia.
No worries. So, Dr. Porter, could you speak to, you spoke about male people of color being teachers. What about administrators and trying to kind of curb that school to prison pipeline and kind of the higher up leadership positions? What opinion do you have about that?
Just like with teachers, that is something that needs to be addressed and fixed. During my research, I was using a major school district, and some of the statistics that I received as far as how many Black administrators were, it was dismal. It was really dismal. I wish I had thought to maybe have my dissertation over here. I could have the exact number. But that also starts with the teachers that are there now that are in the school system. They need to step up with whoever would like to step up and start thinking more about how they can not only help in the classroom, but moving up to administration. Now, once you move up to administration, now you have more of a platform and you have even more time and even more of an opportunity to bring in Black teachers, to mentor the new Black teachers that are coming in. And then the teachers that are coming in from colleges, from schools themselves, you can mentor them and it can just continue to snowball that way. But the teachers who are in the system now, they should consider being administrators. And a lot of them don't. Now, like I said, I used to work in the school, and there were quite a few of them that were content with just, you know, being a teacher, which is fine. Some of them were not in it for the correct reasons, but there were a lot that were just like, I'm good being here, and I will keep my class and keep my second graders until I retire. But maybe they should really think about moving up to administration.
Hello.
Sort of a follow up to that. Go ahead, Dorothy, and I'll.
No, I was just saying challenge. That's a challenge. Make it heard.
Yeah, definitely. So what strategies do you think are effective and what strategies are not effective that you've seen in recruiting Black teachers into the classroom just initially?
Well, one thing that I have noticed is possibly the pay. the teaching profession is not as respected as many other professions. So as a result, many students do not even go into college wanting to be teachers. Part of my research was about why some of these African-American males became teachers anyway, despite some of the challenges and things that they faced while growing up. And I think that some type of a program or some type of curriculum that is introduced as early as middle school, particularly focused on male students, minority male students, something that at that young age makes education attractive and makes it something that they want to pursue as a career, because right now, it, like I said, it's not one of those careers that, you know, people say, back in the day, people did used to say, oh, I want to be a teacher. And it's not so much so now. You know, you have business, you have athletics, you have other areas that are not as well represented by people in general, let alone African-Americans. So that needs to be changed as far as making the occupation even attractive, something that they even want to do. And then once they are in, mentoring, I cannot stress mentoring enough. Reach back and pull up someone to where you are. And then when someone does the same to you, it keeps going.
Dr. Porter, I just wanted to read this really quick. This was from the Facebook. Dr. Reeves shares, school to prison pipeline starts with the school board. They write the policies that say a hallway fight must be reported to the police, for example. Anyone can run for school board. So we could try that route.
Right, and also piggybacking on that, the discipline or the how Black children are disciplined more than white children are. They're suspended more. They are expelled more. That again, it not only does that contribute to school to prison pipeline, but that goes back to my point about, you know, psychologically, that messes with them.
Nadine, you ready?
Yes. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sweetheart.
Okay, great. So I just wanted to comment on Dr. Porter's mention of education and how implicit bias is very prevalent in education in America. I'm part of the My Reading Warriors branch of my Project USA. So my position includes choosing books, the books that the children will read. And until I started, I didn't realize just how difficult it was to find books that go beyond, you know, just mentioning all white children, or if not that, you know, to find books that do have Black people in it. It's usually just not relevant to what they want to learn about. So why is it that when we talk about books that contain white characters, it's always like the Marvel characters and it's fun, but whenever I want to mention something that's relevant to them, the only thing that tends to be available is you know, things that are nonfiction, and they don't always want that. They sometimes want something that's fun and seeing people that are like them that are doing things that they like to do. So I just wanted to mention that.
Well, going back to what you said about Marvel, I don't know how much of a known fact this is, but you know, you do have your Black representation. With Black Panther, and Black Panther did not just start. Black Panther was introduced, I think, about 1966, mm-hmm. or something like that. So they are there. They are unfortunately not as prevalent. You do have to search a little bit more, mm-hmm. but that is something that we are seeing now that is changing. Definitely. Things are coming out more. And as more information becomes available as far as nonfiction characters, and of course, nonfiction characters are being created mm-hmm. daily. So at some point, mm-hmm. the nonfiction character, I'm sorry, the nonfiction character, characters being created today, or the fictional character, I'm sorry, that's being created today is going to be the Black Panther 50 years from now.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's definitely true. I just didn't realize how much effort one has to put in. If you take the easiest path, then the information that you do present will be biased. And I didn't realize that actually you have to watch yourself. You have to make sure that you're providing information that's accurate and relevant to who you're talking to, and that's not biased. And yes.
This is why we do this. We've got some young people, and I think someone, and that's how old I am, is that I forget who said it, and it was literally 5 minutes ago, but someone mentioned about the youth. Again, these are our youth, and these are the youth that we are working with and who are working with us, and just their spirit, their youth, they know what they want to see. And Dr. Porter shared that there is a new tide coming. There is a new tide that is slowly coming ashore that says diversity is cool, that says inclusion must be. And we've given the reins to young people to keep us honest, to keep our work honest. What do you want diversity to look like? What do you want inclusion to look like? And our young people are always, Reading Warriors is a literacy program that we have, and they're always out there fighting. There's librarians in this program that their sole job is to make sure that the children we serve see themselves in the joys of literature. They see themselves doing, like she said, real life things, being awesome and being courageous. So Nadine, thank you and your team, of course, for doing what you continue to do. Dr. Porter, thank you so much for being here with us.
There was one other question. I don't know if you saw it. There was a question that someone asked in the chat about the 1918 project.
I'm sorry, yep. Dr. Porter, what is your take on having the 1918 project included in high school curriculums? Evidently, it is causing some controversy in state education legislature. Thank you. And that's from Julia.
I can just answer that very quickly. Just as I said before, it's uncomfortable, but it's time. It is something that should be taught. It is a part of our history, no matter how negative it is, no matter how negative it comes across. You cannot go forward without at least acknowledging your past, not dwelling in it, but at least acknowledge it and make stepping forth to correct it. So I think the reason why it is controversial is because it's uncomfortable. Just like, I guess at some point teaching about enslaved people was uncomfortable. So that's why they softened it and did everything else, made it not so bad. It's uncomfortable, but it's something that needs to be taught.
Thank you, everybody. We have another 8 minute break here. Everybody was able to come back, I think, on time last time. So thank you guys. Facebook, the audience on Facebook is multiplying. So I hope everybody has on their superstar hat today. Thank you. Thank you guys. I feel like this is the conversation that we needed to have. I hope that everyone is feeling educated and empowered. We will be back at noon with Dr. Jamar Jeffers, and this is going to blow your mind. That's it.
Yes, thank you very much. And yes, Dr. Jeff, don't worry about it.
We'll see you guys at noon. Thank you. Thank you so much. Enjoy your break.